Welcome wherever you are to the Writers Trust Awards. First and foremost, I'll ask you to join us in acknowledging that the land on which we are filming is part of the Dish with One Spoon territory, named for a treaty between the Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Mississaugas of the New Credit. This treaty bound them to share the territory and protect the land of the Dish, which represents what is now known as Southern Ontario. Since its creation, subsequent Indigenous nations and peoples, Europeans and all the newcomers, have been incorporated into the treaty in the spirit of peace, friendship, and respect. We extend our gratitude to the past, present, and future elders and teachers who carried the knowledge of this land. We are truly grateful for the opportunity to create, live, learn, read, and write on this land together. Thank you. My name is Kamal Asulaili. I'm the author of the memoir Intolerable and a book of nonfiction called Brown. I'll be your host this afternoon. Over the next 25 minutes, we will meet the 10 incredible writers nominated for two Writers' Trust Awards and reveal the prize winners. Like today's finalist, I've had the good fortune to be nominated for a Writers' Trust Award twice in my case. I even won one of them, and it's a great feeling. A prize nomination is the culmination of years of work and an acknowledgement from your peers. It's a message writers love to hear, perhaps more so this year than in the past. The lucky among us are trapped at home right now, plunking away at the keyboard in their pajamas. This is what we used to think of as the modern writer's life. And it's great. Well, at times. If everything is going well and you can manage the frequent surges of anxiety. But hearing that a panel of your contemporaries read your work and deemed it one of the year's best, well, that can bring a ray of sunshine to a writer's life. I'm delighted both as a Writers' Trust Award alum and a director of the organization to be able to share that sentiment with today's nominees. During the last month, each of the finalists spoke to us about their book. You will hear their voices in turn and see some of the images they provided that relate to their work and the inspiration behind it. Let's discover what they shared, beginning with the finalist for the Writers' Trust Fiction Prize. This award is given to an author of exceptional talent in recognition of the year's best novel or short story collection. The eventual prize winner will receive $50,000. The 2020 finalists were selected by Elizabeth DiMariafi, Wabgishig Rice, and Isuko Ton. And here are the finalists.
Set during World War I in the wilds of Alberta and Montana, Ridgerunner is about a father separated from his son and a son yearning to go home. Freedom and imprisonment, about our relationship to the natural world and to so-called civilization, and about how, like it or not, we are very much connected to one another. I was really driven to write about the prisoner of war camps in Canada during the First World War, the Ukrainian prisoner of war camp in particular called Castle Mountain Camp. For me, it was important to not use my characters as pawns or as, you know, positions or as examples of anything, but to try my best to make them as full, rich, real, complex people as close as is possible in fiction. William Morland sat in excruciated patience and waited for his meal. He put his hands between his knees to stop them shaking. He was not a soldier come back from war, not a park ranger, not any sort of a good man. In fact, to his own astonishment, he had firm plans to become even worse.
After her cousin's death, Lucy finds herself transformed into a lay confessor, or in her own words, a flesh and blood wailing wall, as complete strangers begin to approach her everywhere she goes and divulge their deepest, darkest secrets to her. Some of the things I was exploring in The Beguiling I don't see in the cultural conversation very much today. That women are not necessarily morally superior to men. That motherhood doesn't necessarily make you a more sensitive, better person. That good people will do all kinds of hideous things in the name of love. Those first few months, the burden came at me much like the New Testament's disaffected and leprous swarms in a scene straight out of Jesus Christ Superstar. They didn't seek absolution, at least not overtly. It was more akin to a divestment, like snakes twisting out of their old skin in order to rid themselves of parasites.
Five Little Indians is the story of five residential school survivors that focuses not so much on their experiences in the residential school, but on the traumas that they carry with them throughout their life after they leave the school. I looked at the kinds of harms that survivors experienced as a result of their treatment at residential school, and I started the characters not as people, but as harms. And then I asked myself, what kind of person would this person grow into? We often hear that chorus of why can't they just get over it? That trauma doesn't simply disappear once you've left the residential school. The trauma continues to echo through their lives, both as individuals and collectively in our communities. Kenny walked along the meandering creek, enjoying the sound of it when it narrowed and quickened, the peace of it when it widened and slowed, deeper and quieter, the rusty-colored stones casting a sparkling copper tone on the crystalline water. There was a bitter sweetness in seeing his old friend. He was happy to share their tricky survival memories. It was the ones that slipped in through the silences, that he was relieved to lose in his usual solitude.
Indians on Vacation is about the world as seen through a trip that two senior Indians take to Prague. But I knew it was going to be a multi-layered book, that I would take people backwards and forwards in the lives of these two characters. But every so often I had to come back to Prague. Prague was my base in the book. The thing that is new in this novel are the demons. And one of the things that was difficult for me to do was to A, admit that I have my own demons, and B, then to show them off in fiction. It was like drawing blood to describe these characters and the kind of damage that they do to an individual and still make them charming, if you will. I'm not sure why we travel. The default response is that we travel in order to see new places, to meet new peoples, to broaden our understanding of the world. Whereas I tend to see travel as punishment for those of us who can afford such mistakes. Travel does allow us to collect new adventures, gather up new stories we can share with family and friends. The problem is that travel stories are only interesting if something untoward happens, if trouble makes an appearance, if a disaster is survived.
So my book is a linked story collection set in Ukraine, right before and after the collapse of the Soviet Union, so a very turbulent historical period. The book is about a group of people who live in a tenement building. So it's really about ordinary people and how they survive and thrive in some pretty extraordinary times. The physical structure of the building in this book is what inspired the structure of the story collection. People lived in pretty cramped quarters in these Soviet block buildings. So as suspicious as the tenants are of each other, and as much as they try to stay out of each other's way, they simply can't, and their lives inevitably intersect. So that's why I knew that these stories had to be connected as well. I'd been working as a guard at the Saint's Tomb for 18 months before the trouble began. Konstantin Ilyich paid me little, but provided free lodging, an army cot and stove I could fold out in the corner of the tomb each night. The job consisted of telling pilgrims to keep hands out of pockets and lips off the display case. Sometimes children wrapped the glass, bored by the saint's inactivity, and I would remind them that we were not a zoo.
And the winner is Gil Adamson for Ridgerunner, published by House of Anansi Press.
Thank you very much. It is an honor to receive this award, and it is a surprise. I'm lucky to even be on this list, given the caliber of the books on it and the talents of my fellow nominees. It's too bad we can't all be together at an award dinner and get to know one another better, but that is the world we live in now. The Writers Trust does so much good work through its various awards and programs, and I personally know a number of writers whose lives have been temporarily but substantially changed by it, as my life is changed right now by this award. Writing is a solitary endeavor, and you never know when you finish a book what its prospects will be. I am so very proud to accept this award in this very strange year for us all. Authors get all the praise, but the fact is that books are in important ways collaborative, so I must mention a small number of people. Thank you to Senator Patty LaBoucane Benson and Lloyd Buddy Wesley for their expertise and generosity. Buddy did the Nakota translations for my book. Thank you to my agent, Ellen Levine, and Sarah McLaughlin, who is a force of nature, who acquired Ridgerunner and its predecessor, The Outlander, and who has always believed in my work. Janie Yoon for her thorough and thoughtful edits and her very good advice. Maria Golikova for the most detailed and generous production edit I've ever seen, let alone experienced. To Peter Norman and Melanie Little for saving me from myself. Alicia Shuchuk for the spooky, beautiful cover. Also, thank you to Karen Brochu, Joshua Greenspan, and Curtis Samuel, and the picture of Grace Under Fire, Debbie DeGroot, for holding a very shy person's hands during the publicity for this book. I thank you all. And finally, to the poet Kevin Conley for editing every word I write, giving brilliant and helpful advice, and being so reassuringly sane. Everyone should have someone like Kevin in their lives. When I heard that I had won the Writers Trust Fiction Prize, my first thought was, there's the start of my next book. That's what funding the arts does. It creates more art. So thank you all so much.
Congratulations, Jill. Before we present our next prize, I'd like to introduce Catherine Clark, Chair of the Writers Trust, to share a few words.
Hi, I'm Catherine Clark. As Chair of the Writers Trust, I can't tell you how delighted I am to welcome you to the Writers Trust Awards Books of the Year edition. We are extremely excited to present these two prizes today and absolutely thrilled to put a spotlight on the wonderful books created by these 10 finalists. Founded in 1976, the mission of the Writers Trust is to advance, nurture, and celebrate Canadian writers so our country's voices are heard from coast to coast to coast and beyond. As we move into 2021, the Writers Trust's 45th year, we will continue to demonstrate our commitment to writers who face daunting and unprecedented challenges. Now, today's prizes are typically presented at a packed to the rafters cocktail party attended by writers and editors and agents and members of the literary community. It's an evening where so many who share a passion for stories and art come together as a community and applaud the year's finest. Of course, we're all just drinking alone at home these days. But what truly matters is not the party, it's the writers and their stories, how they shape and sculpt the written word, and how they capture ideas and feelings that once felt indescribable. 2020 has proven to be a supremely challenging year for everyone, but that only makes today's opportunity to spotlight the awe-inspiring range, ambition, and eloquence of today's finalists even more important. I'd like to acknowledge a few key supporters who've made the Writers Trust Awards Books of the Year edition possible. Our presenting partner, the Humber School for Writers, our media partner, the Globe and Mail, the Government of Canada through the Department of Canadian Heritage, and project partners Indigo, CBC Books, Quill and Choir, and White Pine Pictures, the producer of this video, as well as the numerous corporate, foundation, and individual sponsors who support the Writers' Trust. Thank you to all of you, most sincerely.
And now to present this afternoon's final prize. The Hilary Weston Writers' Trust Prize for Nonfiction is given to the author of the year's best work of literary nonfiction. The nominated titles demonstrate a distinctive voice as well as a persuasive and compelling command of tone, narrative, style, and technique. Valued at $60,000, this is the richest annual literary award for a book of nonfiction given to a Canadian writer. This year's jury was composed of Helen Knott, Sandra Martin, and Ronald Wright. And here are the finalists.
I lived with my husband for over 40 years, and a few years ago, he became deathly ill, and I decided to write about that, and in doing so, I also revisited our past, how we met, the five cats who lived with us, and how and why poetry was a passion in our lives. The task of poetry is not to explain or argue, but to dance people into an experience so that they feel what it was like to be there. I hope that's what this book does, that the reader gets involved with the grit and the sinew of what is being described. Writing itself can be a consolation and a salvation. It's not that it takes away the pain of a troubling experience, but it clarifies the pain. It makes it more lucent. Daily I catch sight of the vibrant, confident Patrick, the way you glimpse someone waving from the window of a train pulling out of a station. I wave and wave and long for his return. Then I gather myself. Walk the cinder path from the railroad tracks to where I've left the car, pull out of the parking lot, and join the stream of traffic because I don't know where to go, what to do.
Reaching Mithymna is my account of serving with international volunteers and aid workers on the Isle of Lesvos in the fall of 2015. When tens of thousands of mainly Syrian war refugees were arriving there. Because the crisis was still happening 3 years later, it seemed that the material was still urgent and it felt necessary to bear witness. Once I decided to write the book, it came together really quickly, possibly because I didn't have many notes. I remembered basically what happened, but I had to recreate to a great extent, and that's one reason I changed the names of all the characters in the book. So I've tried to use all the techniques of fiction and poetry to make the reader feel that they're present in the moment on the beach when refugee rafts are coming in, because data and facts and stats don't move people. Flashlight beams converge on a tight cluster of faces and torsos gliding in toward the beach. The raft itself is hardly visible. The top of the bow like a black rubber snout. The pontoon-like gunwales barely above water. Some of the passengers are sobbing, shrieking, as if the sight of us terrifies them. My throat seizes up. My eyes sting.
Two Trees was a story I'd been trying to tell for a really long time. It was an idea I'd tried out as a novel and then filed away until it came back to me years later as a letter from my grandfather, which was his life story written in Chinese. So I set about trying to understand his story alongside really trying to understand the places that he'd moved through from China to Taiwan to Canada. I was searching for a language that overlapped between my grandparents and my Mandarin was never good when I was growing up, and they didn't speak a lot of English. I needed to find some shared language, and that for me, you know, was in the natural world, in environment, in plants, in place, and in the places they'd moved through. That's a more fluent language for me in a way, as an environmental historian. There are a lot of moments where I think languages exist in multiplicity on the page, and that was really important to me. Disruption is written in the island's stone. Forged in movement, scattered with dormant volcanic hills and slopes that rise from sea to sky so swiftly they cannot be captured in a single glance. It is a place that demands time and slow attention, but can be undone in a single moment of subterranean trembling.
Shame on Me is about race and belonging. It's about finding new ways of looking at these issues, but it's also about language and the poetry that exists between people. And it's about how important language is in remaking our possible futures in a world that is so divided by structural inequality. I think I've been writing the book for my whole life because it's a process of understanding my place in the world and my place as a woman of color. So I structured the book as a scientific experiment because I was writing back against race science, switching back and forth between a kind of language of science and a language of poetry is absolutely what I intended to do in the book, because I wanted to show that there are different systems of knowledge, you know, and that they can work with each other as well as against each other. As I once longed for a singular place, a singular ethnicity or plot of land over generations, I now long for its opposite, for a space beyond belonging. I have traveled to many places in order to scope a sense of ownership or repatriation, but as I try to square my politics with my privilege, it seems that my only true inheritance is that I am always running somewhere else.
When I sat down to write The Way Home, I thought that I was writing a book about my unusual art practice because I work in a number of artistic media, you know, I'm a photographer, artist, and a writer. But when I started working on the material and laying out the chapters, what I found was the interesting story was how I'd found my way home after 25 years away to become a traditional artist like generations of my family before me. My story, the story of finding a way home, is something that's unusual in the First Nations community and is very relevant because so many First Nations people find themselves alienated from their community and their traditions, their culture. It was always my idea that the images would be wedded to the text and they would reinforce it. Seems to me a much richer experience when you can see art and portraits and jewelry, the path that has been my life. Dramatically lit and surrounded by deep shadows, it communicated with me at a visceral level. I could feel my connection to that mask as though it had an energy of its own that made me need to know more. What it represented, where it came from, and who had carved it. Those questions came into my mind, and I felt I already knew the answers. I suspected that the mask had been carved by one of my ancestors, and I studied for a long time, waiting for it to raise its mysteries to me.
To announce the winner of the prize, I'm delighted to introduce you to the Honorable Hilary M. Weston.
Thank you, Kamal, and good afternoon to everyone. Today marks the 10th time I have had the pleasure of announcing the winner of this prize. In a year that has brought Canadians such uncertainty and tremendous challenges, it remains an honour to continue to recognise and reward storytellers who make sense of our shared world. This year's Nonfiction finalists reveal the depth and richness of writing in this country. While all five finalists' works are labelled as memoirs, they are much more than personal stories. They each unfold across a larger canvas and tell a broader narrative that illuminates our understanding of important and of-the-moment issues. It is a privilege to celebrate the work of Canada's finest writers of true stories through this prize, and to help these exemplary works find readers at home and abroad. While each book is different, each author is extraordinary. Congratulations to all five of this year's finalists. But before the winner is revealed, I'd like to acknowledge the prize jurors. They've approached their work with dedication, rigor, and a discerning eye. In selecting this year's very best Canadian nonfiction, they have chosen outstanding titles. Selecting a winner must have been tremendously difficult. On behalf of the Writers' Trust of Canada and myself, thank you to Helen Knott, Sandra Martin, and Ronald Wright. And now, the winner of the 2020 Hilary Weston Writers' Trust Prize for Nonfiction is Jessica J. Lee for Two Trees Make a Forest, published by Hamish Hamilton Canada. Congratulations, Jessica.
Wow. Thank you so much to the jury, the Writers' Trust, Hilary Weston, and the Weston Family Foundation. This prize provides such extraordinary support to Canadian nonfiction, and I'm frankly astounded to join a list of authors that I've long looked up to. I'd quickly like to thank Nicole Winstanley at Hamish Hamilton and the entire team at Penguin Canada. This book took many years and a huge amount of support from the team there at Catapult and at Virago. And at DGA, David, Lisette, and Philippa, who get my words in front of the right editors, thank you. Growing up, I was a voracious reader of nature writing, but I so rarely saw stories like my own. But in recent years, I feel like that's been really changing, and to be any small part of that shift is incredible. Writing Two Trees was a sort of exercise in finding the overlap between a migration story and a nature story. And I've been so grateful to see it find its readers, especially amongst the Taiwanese diaspora in Canada and elsewhere. There are tons of people who need to be thanked, my husband among them, but those are all in the acknowledgements. For now, I'll say this wouldn't have been possible without the generosity of my mother, who not only gave me my grandfather's story, but her blessing to write it. Mama, wo ai ni. And to Puo and Gong, my grandparents, let this serve as a record that you and so many people like you who came to Canada leaving everything behind, you're remembered and loved. So thank you very much.
Congratulations, Jessica. On behalf of the Writers' Trust, I'd like to thank you for joining us. And congratulations again to today's winners, as well as the rest of the year's finalists. Additionally, I'd like to thank the sponsors and partners that made these prizes and today's program possible. A quick reminder that next month, on December 2nd, the Writers' Trust will continue to present the Writers' Trust Awards with the Career Honors Edition, which will feature four prizes and $100,000 to the recipients of the Writers' Trust Engle Findlay Award, the Lettner Writers' Trust Poetry Prize, the Vicky Metcalf Award for Literature for Young People, and the Matt Cohen Award in celebration of a writing life. We encourage you to watch our social channels that day to discover the prize winners and what their writing is all about. More information is available at writerstrust.com. Until then.